Have you heard of the eighth natural wonder of the world? This week's episode is all about this magical, stunning part of New Zealand, Milford Sound in the Fiordland National Park. This was one of those experiences that was so incredible that it will definitely be a lifelong memory. We talk about it all the time and tell everyone we can to go and visit. And now you get to hear about it too. Not only are we going to take you cruising on the 16 kilometre long, 290 metre deep sound, with 1,600 metre sheer cliffs and 1,000 metre waterfalls, we also take you hiking in the lush rainforest. Come with us as we tell you about the underwater observatory where you can see rare black coral. We also tell you about the gorgeous little town with a massive lake that is a bit of a secret and is the best place to stay if you want to have a few days in the area. Stay listening to the end to hear about our helicopter flight where we land on a glacier. Yes, we actually landed on top of an actual glacier. It was freaking incredible. It was like being on top of the world. We give you all the options of how to explore this spectacular area, where to stay, and what we would do different if we went back again. Spoiler alert, stay longer in the only luxury accommodation at Milford Sound. Remember, if you want to see all the pictures and check out the map and the links to the tours, accommodation, and helicopter flights, then go to the description on the podcast player you are now listening on and click the link to episode 77. Please enjoy this week's episode all about the stunning, beautiful, incredible Milford Sound in the Fiordland National Park, New Zealand. Hey there, fellow travel and wine enthusiasts. Welcome to Beach Travel Wine, where we dive deep into destinations, sipping on stories and soaking up the vibes. We're at a crossroads trying to figure out our next adventure. Personally, I'd love to return to the sunny coast of Spain. So if you've been tuning in, you know we love to set up shop in a place and unpack all its treasures. We've got a trove of over 20 podcasts on Spain and Italy, heaps on Australia and a bunch on Mexico. And right now, we're knee deep in uncovering all things Queenstown and its stunning surroundings in New Zealand. Our thing is quality over quantity. We cater to the 50-somethings who enjoy a bit of luxury. You know, folks who don't want to fuss with all the nitty-gritty but want the lowdown on the best tours, coolest restaurants and those hidden gems in every nook and cranny of a city. Here's the scoop. We're all ears for suggestions on where to head next. Got a favourite spot? We're all ears. And here's the kicker. Maybe you or someone you know runs a tourist spot, a sweet little B&B or a cool travel agency. Imagine us dedicating a series of podcasts to your spot, bringing in your ideal visitors and putting your slice of paradise in the limelight. If you're up for a chat or a brainstorm, hit us up. Drop us a message through the link in this podcast description or slide into our DMs over at Beach Travel Wine on Instagram. Let's brew something up awesome together and give our listeners a taste of the world's best kept secrets. Cheers. Kia ora, Lyle. Welcome back to the Beach Travel Wine podcast studio. How are you?
Kia ora, Leonita.
Are you good?
I'm fabulous today.
Yeah. Oh, I know. How good is this podcast going to be? Giving us a bit of rap before we even start. But
wow, it was probably one of our favourite things we ever did.
I know, right? And yeah. As I said in the intro, it's all about the beautiful Milford Sound and the just gorgeous national park area of New Zealand.
Yeah, so what we're going to do is we're going to catch a helicopter and we're going to fly to the magnificent Milford Sound, and then we're going to take a couple of hour cruise, and then we're going to fly back to Queenstown. So,
oh, you missed a big step in there.
Did I?
Yeah.
What's that?
We're going to land on a glacier.
That's true. That's true.
Well, to me, that's pretty impressive. You're actually landing and you hop out and you're on top of a glacier.
Yeah, look, it was, yeah. I still, every time I think about it, I'm blown away with it. How magnificent it was. Anyway, why don't you get on with it, yeah, and tell
well,
the folks.
Well, what we did was we were in Queenstown and we went out to the airport, and that's where we, you know, you do all your pre-getting weighed in, which is always a bit of an issue, isn't it?
Yes, yes, that's true.
I had to fill in this form and I go over and put your names down and how much you think you weigh. So obviously there's a few mistakes made there. And I'm like, oh, Lyle's already done this. You know, there's a name above me with McCabe, which was our surname. And I said, look, and I turned around to say something to you. And then I realized it said Dan McCabe. And and I'm like, hang on, you've got a nephew, Dan McCabe.
It was all very confusing.
Anyway, big story, just for not that interesting for anyone else, I guess. But, you know, there's only four of us going on the helicopter ride. It was another couple, and one of them was Dan McCabe.
So and his girlfriend.
Tegan.
Who's
his wife, and they've got a lovely little boy. And, yeah, so we had such a fun day together. We stayed in contact. But here's the thing they had, which I was so disappointed we didn't have. Do you remember?
Yeah, they had a bottle of champagne.
I know, because I didn't realise. You can stop when you get off the helicopter on the glacier. You can actually have a glass of wine. Anyway, so we're on a helicopter. Yeah.
So
I think what you've got is you've got a description of what the brochure says.
So this is what got us in.
So you want to tell us what it says.
It says, explore stunning Milford Sound from the air and on the water. Upon landing in Milford Sound, join an unforgettable cruise past sheer cliffs, cascading waterfalls, and perhaps even spot dolphins, seals, and penguins. Enjoy flying along breathtaking mountain ranges before experience a glacier landing in the heart of Fiordland. It's approximately 4 hours.
Yeah, okay. Well, so you'd imagine, you take off and you instantly, the views. If you go to Queenstown, you need to go and see it from the air. Even flying in, as we said. So 4 hours, 2 hours flying the helicopter, and it's a 2-hour cruise, right? That's what we did. But we're going to tell you about other ways you can get there as well. So, so we flew by helicopter and flew back by helicopter. But, there are some cheaper options and not just cheaper options, but, like the drive there is very scenic as well. So you can take a bus, can you?
Yeah. Look, there's probably 4 or 5 ways to get there. You can drive yourself. It's about 296 kilometres, so it's going to take you about 3.5 hours, but that's if you don't stop.
And that's if the weather's good.
It is... During winter, it is avalanche season, and they say that you must take change. So that's one way.
The bus takes about 6 hours, doesn't it?
Yeah, you can take the bus, and they say that the scenery is just magnificent, and that takes about 6 hours. And the reason for that, it does stop at a lot of places.
Well, and I've seen the bus, and it's got like windows even in the roof area, so when you think of bus, you think you're stuck in a bus, but you can actually, and I've seen videos of people driving along, and there's a couple of iconic spots on the drive that I think that's why people want to take the bus, where you come across this massive mountain, and just as you sort of take the sweeping turn, this comes up in front of you, and if it's been raining, this mountain literally has hundreds of little waterfalls all coming down it. It's stunning. So yeah, it's worth going to have a look at that if you want to drive.
Yeah. So if you drive again, if you drive yourself, just be aware you will have to book your cruise when you get there, and they recommend that you wait till they get there, because it doesn't put pressure on you driving there. Under can be quite dangerous conditions, so they say there's about 4 companies there, so you can book that. Now the other way to get there is to you can actually just catch a fixed wing plane from Queenstown Airport to Milford Sound, and then there's also the package, which is you can fly there by fixed wing aircraft, take the cruise, and also then fly back.
Mm-hmm. Or there is bus, cruise.
Oh, that's
fly
right. Sorry,
home.
Yeah.
So there's bus, a whole,
cruise, come fly home. There's
I'm going to put a link to the company that we went, and you can check out that to see what options are available. There are sort of private, obviously, hires that you can do as well. So, but we probably should. And I'll tell you, that was the other thing I was going to say before we talk a bit more about it, is one of the stunning things, besides we're going to talk about landing on the glacier a bit later, but actually coming into Milford Sound, I'm sure it'd be the same as you took off. You can't really imagine this. The mountains are so high and the water is, they're lush and there's waterfalls everywhere, and then you see the mountains covered in snow. It is one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my life. So whether you fly in or fly out, I certainly recommend that you do that at Milford Sound, yeah?
Oh, yeah, the whole...
You'll never see anything like it
again. The whole feel of flying along that Milford Sound above the snow-capped mountains, along the...
You come down through the valley.
Oh, and it's just magnificent.
So before we get ahead of ourselves... because I could just go on and on about how beautiful this place is. First thing I want to say is go to our the podcast player you're listening in now, the description there, and there'll be a link to the show notes with this episode. And I know I have said this before, but you'll really want to see these pictures. They're just stunning. But let's talk a bit about, we're sort of talking like everyone knows what Milford Sound is, yeah? So we probably should explain a bit more about the history of it and the geography of it and that sort of stuff, yeah?
Okay, so Milford Sound, or in Maori, Piopiotahi, is a fjord in the southwest of New Zealand's South Island. It's known for its towering mitre peak, plus rainforest and waterfalls.
Now, that mitre peak is the biggest one, which is 1,692 metres.
Correcto.
It's...
So it's huge.
Yeah, it's stunning.
The fjord is home to fur seal colonies, penguins and dolphins.
We saw some seals on our tour.
Yeah, Milford's Discovery Centre, an underwater observatory, offers views of rare black coral and other marine life. Look, the area is 25 square kilometres of the sound.
Which is the water part.
Yeah. The maximum depth is 291 metres or 955 feet. Now, there's Maori history. In Maori legend, Milford Sound has formed by the Te Te Raki Wanaeho. He was an atua, which is a godly figure, who was in charge of shaping the Fiordland coast. Chanting a powerful kariyaka, which is a prayer, he hacked at the towering rock walls with his toki, which is an axe, called Te Hamo, and carved it from the earth. Mm. When the legendary hero Maui, I've got a pair of Maori gym sunglasses, yes. Maui, which is a trickster god, died trying to win immortality for his beloved people. Mm. Piopio, a long distinct extinct native bird, was said to have flown here in mourning.
Right.
Not okay. In the morning, in mourning. Now, the European history, in 1823, a sealer, John Grano, was the first European settler to visit and named it Milford Sound after Milford Haven, a long, narrow inlet on the Welsh coast. Mm. A Scotsman called Donald Sutherland became Milford Sound's first permanent resident. Sutherland chose a spot to live near what is now called Lady Bowen Falls. Sutherland built the first hotel to accommodate the growing number of walkers arriving there on what is now the Milford Track. From 1935, workers began to build the Homer Tunnel, drilling through solid rock from Hollyford Valley into the Claydale Valley, which was opened in 1954, allowing an access road to Milford Sound. The tunnel is 1.2 kilometres long. Mm. In 1990, Milford Sound, along with the rest of the Fiordland and three other national parks, was named a UNESCO World Heritage Site.
Yeah, so that's a lot of history there. Maybe you need to explain too, this opens out into the Southern Ocean.
Yeah, look.
Doesn't it? So where you get on the boat is sort of obviously the land part of New Zealand, and, they've got the information centre there where you can book and all that sort of stuff. And then you hop on, it's quite a decent sized boat. There are different companies that do the tours, and you do the tour, you go around the edge of the cliffs, and they take you and point out the different waterfalls and things. Yeah.
Yeah. Look, Milford Sound is a long, narrow inlet.
Oh, here we go. Sorry. Yeah, you got it.
Is a long, narrow inlet located at the northernmost end of Fiordland National Park, opening out onto the Tasman Sea. The length of Milford Sound is approximately 16 kilometres or 9.94 miles.
So that's from where you get on the boat out to the ocean.
Which is basically the Southern Ocean. So once you get there, the next step is Antarctica.
Antarctica.
So
there are cruise ships that actually come in, big cruise ships that come into the Milford Sound as well. So
yeah,
I've seen those.
The rocks that make up Milford Sound are were once part of a huge mountain range on the mega continent of Gondwanaland over 600 million years ago. Over the course of hundreds of millions of years, they were reshaped by erosion and the movement of tectonic plates deep under the earth. Glacier rivers. Glacier rivers of ice up to 2 kilometres wide descended from the Southern Alps and flowed slowly down to the sea, carving the course out of sound, a solid rock. As they went later, as the earth warmed, the glaciers retreated and ice rivers melted. In some places, the trenches and valleys they left became lakes, including lakes Te Anahu and Manapouri. In Milford Sound, they created a fjord, a sheer, narrow valley opening out to the sea with high cliffs on either side.
Okay, so that's what we're talking about. And that's the 16-kilometre long area. So that was by 2,000, what was it, 2 kilometre wide glacier? Is that what
you said?
So the ice is strong enough to break the rock.
Yeah, carve it out, yes.
Wow.
So because obviously, and glacier is basically a snow that has been turned into ice, all right? And they just get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And
they're moving all the time.
And they're moving all the time because of the increase in the weight.
And also they're downhill.
So yeah.
Gravity, I guess.
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
And you said they're moving, you know, like 1 or 2 centimetres.
Well, on average, they say they can be moved 1 to 2 centimetres a day. But I'm sure in Greenland, there's some that move up to 40 metres.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Well, you wouldn't want to land a helicopter on those, would you?
No.
40 metres. Wow. Yeah, so it's just this, you know, like as it's been described as the eighth natural wonder of the world for a reason. And, you know, we're trying to give you some idea of, you know, the enormity of it and what's here at Milford Sound, hey?
Yeah, and they say that like it's just as magnificent in cold and rainy weather because there's so many more waterfalls.
Yeah,
and, you know,
waterfalls
so
everywhere.
Look at it was.
And I saw a video where waterfalls coming down. It was so windy that the water was blowing sideways.
Yeah, horizontally. Yeah.
So the main waterfalls in Milford Sound are Lady Bowen and Stirling Falls.
Great. Right?
And they're the ones that you see when you're on the boat cruise. Now, I think you said you can have lunch there and it's about a 2-hour cruise. And even if you're inside, like some people don't want to be outside, and you can still see everything because they've got the floor to ceiling.
Well, that was a discussion we had the other day because Leanne, when we were sort of organizing this, Leanne decided she was going to remind me of how much of a sook I was because I did spend a fair amount of the cruise inside in the warmth rather than where, and because you can see through the ceiling, like so it's a glass ceiling, so you can see everything. But Leanne, she had this idea that she was going to go out onto the deck and she was going to experience chill.
And you go so close to the waterfall that you get the spray off that as well.
You do, because the boat actually goes into the waterfall, basically, the bottom of the waterfall.
Yeah,
you were. And
they also do a commentary, which is really, they give you all this information, you know, because there's so much to learn about it. And they have earphones for translate other languages.
For other languages. Yeah. So it's really well
free
organized.
Free tea and coffee. And, yeah. We probably bought a wine.
We're probably more than likely. Why wouldn't we?
Why wouldn't you? That's it.
But
the water is it's dark colour, isn't it, from all the tannins in the water. So
yeah, so the water, the top 10 metres of the water in the Sound is actually fresh water, and that is because of the the huge amount of rainfall.
Oh,
right,
okay.
And that washes all the vegetation and that into the into the Sound, and with that, obviously, all the tannins and everything come down. Yeah. So that first 10 metres is actually black.
Right.
So when you're and then under that is the seawater. Now, obviously, because of the darkness of the water, the reflections of the cliffs and everything,
the mountains, it
blows you away. Yeah.
I could sit on that boat and just go, you know, because it's still, you know, it's not like the water is flat and still. And if you're on a day where it's not blowing a gale, it's like a mirror, and you're just gliding along through this reflective pond. It looks like a pond, but it's this massive sort of lake at the bottom of these, you know, 1600 meter sheer cliffs. And the cliffs, a lot of them are covered in lush vegetation, obviously, because you said, like, there's so much rain, like, they have lots of wet days there. We once again, lucky Lyle, we snagged, you know, the best day that this pilot had ever. And he said, they might say that to all the girls, but anyway. And then you see like a rock in the distance, and there's these beautiful fur seals sitting on them. And, you know, you look, go around the next little sort of alcove, and there's, you know, another steep cliff just jutting straight out of this reflective water, and another waterfall. And like at one stage, and they might still do it, they were using the waterfalls to generate power.
Yeah, they do. That's
why wouldn't you?
For Milford, so the actual town of Milford Sound. One of the waterfalls, they generate it supplies the water and the electricity. Now, just one thing, which is, I've got to be honest, when we first decided we're going to do this, my whole thing was about the helicopter ride and landing on the glacier. Sure, I'd heard of Milford Sound. I knew that it was such a long drive, and there was no way known I was going to do the drive. So for me, it was more about the helicopter ride.
Sure.
It was really
my favourite form of transport.
Yeah, Leanne's favourite form of transport. But you have no idea how iconic this place is, like the sound itself. Mm. It is unbelievable.
Yeah, you nearly put a...
Now, one thing is...
Well, hang on. I was just going to say, it's my friends from the Mountain Town Ramblers podcast. I told them we were doing a podcast on Milford Sound, and they were like so excited because they said, they just can't wait to get there. And they're from Canada, and they know all about Milford Sound.
Oh, do they? Oh, really? Yeah. I didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah. So, but I mean, that's what I mean. It's so world famous, this place, if you're into mountains and that sort of thing.
Now, I'm going to tell you a little secret.
Well, okay.
It's actually not a sound.
Right.
Sounds are
not a sound.
No, sounds are formed when a river valley is flooded with the sea.
Right.
Whereas Milford Sound carved out by erosion of ancient glacial ice.
Okay.
So I just thought, you know, our listeners would want to know the facts.
I'm sure that, and you know, trust Lyle to bring the facts to you. A couple of things before we move on to the where we're going next. The
National Park,
yes. It just back at, you know, still at Milford Sound. As you mentioned before, there's like the information centre, and that's where you book your tours and that sort of thing. It's also, you can also book as well as the tour on the boat cruise. You did mention there is an underwater observatory. Now, you buy your tickets for that at the centre there, and you basically go out and... then you go down some steps and you end up in this big room 10 metres below the water level, don't you?
Yeah.
And it's really dark, and they've got it lit up, and they've got a special sort of coral there, haven't they?
It's called black coral.
Yeah.
And you would normally only ever be able to see that about 500 metres under the ocean. So, but then you've got the brightly coloured fish and that sort of thing, but you can only get to the observatory by boat.
Yes.
Now, you can do a combined cruise, Milford cruise, and visit to the observatory, and I think you can...
Why wouldn't you do it, right?
Yeah, sure. And you can now also organise a lunch, a picnic lunch or a buffet lunch included in that.
Now, you might be going to mention it later, but I, you know, like we've just gone, you know, given this like 17 and a half points out of 10, you know, as a spot in the world to go to, it did have one downfall. Do you remember what that was?
Sandflies.
Oh, my goodness. Yep. Midges, sandflies, whatever you want to call them. As soon as we got out of the helicopter, you could actually feel them landing on you, remember?
Yeah.
It was like, so make sure you either wear clothes to protect you. And, yeah, we did have, we had jeans and coats and boots on, but, you know, they're on your face, in your hair. Take some spray, what you need to do to keep those away, because they actually have a place called Sandfly Point or something,
don't
they?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
So it's really, they are horrendous, I have to say. All right, so we've talked about Milford Sound and doing the cruise on the sound there. Now, it's part of the Fiordland National Park, isn't it?
That's correct. Now, that occupies the southwest corner of the South Island.
Great segue, Lyle.
It is by far the largest of the 13 national parks in New Zealand.
Yes.
With an area of 12,607 square kilometres or 4,868 square miles. The Fiordland National Park was recognised as a World Heritage Site in 1986.
Mm.
The park is a significant refuge for many threatened native animals, ranging from dolphins and bats to reptiles, insects and birds. Among the birds are several endangered species endemic to New Zealand, such as the takahe mohua, which is a yellowhead, and the critically endangered kakapo, the only flightless parrot in the world. See, I'm not sure why you want to save a flightless parrot. Like, really? Like, it can't fly.
I'm cutting that out, people. You can't say that. Of course you want to say that.
Well, I'm not sure why you're laughing at me.
Because you sound like you're describing a body part back there.
the vulnerable crested penguin and southern brown kiwi are almost exclusively found within the park.
Now, okay, so what you're saying is, like, most national parks full of amazing fauna and animals and flora, and some of them are, you know, like endangered. So it's a pretty important part of the environment of New Zealand. So what else happens in the Fiordland National Park, Lyle?
It's also a popular destination for alpine climbers and especially trampers, with the multi-day Milford, Kepler and Hollyfield tracks and half of the Root Burn track within the park. The latter three can also be walked in and out of as day walks, whereas access to both ends of the Milford track is only via boat and is regulated and must be pre-booked, in particular during summer periods.
All right, so what you're saying is there's some very famous tracks that are multi-day ones.
Yes. Yeah?
And I'm sure the hiker, or trampers, see, you said trampers and you didn't explain that. That is, a tramper is...
A tramper is a New Zealand term.
Yeah, it is. But people don't know that.
Yeah, well,
that come from New Zealand. I didn't know. Like,
well, I didn't know until I looked it up.
Right. So I'm going to explain. A tramper is what in other countries we call them hikers, right?
Sure.
Yeah. But you can actually book huts on these multi-day hikes as well. So.
Well, this is on the Milford Track. The Milford Track is a hiking route located amongst mountains and temperate rainforests. The 53.5 kilometre or 33.2 mile hike starts at Glade Wharf at the head of Lake Te Anahu and finishes in Milford Sound at Sandfly Point.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
Transferring, traversing rainforests, wetlands and an alpine pass. Now, those huts that you were talking about, they're only on that track, the Milford track.
Right.
So, and you must book them.
Yes.
They do have tea and coffee facilities and that sort of thing. But, yeah, it's essential.
You've got to carry your gear with you.
Yeah, that's right.
But the hiking through this, you know, is incredible with the lush rainforest and the mountains. It's so green. It is just so picturesque. There's, you know, thick sort of forest country and just looking at
it's also a renowned destination for rainbow trout and brown trout fly fishing.
Yeah, so of course.
freshwater fishing.
Yeah, yeah. So like it's
got a lot of people go there to do that sort of hunter gatherer thing, don't they?
Yeah. Yeah, or apparently, yeah, it's very popular for that.
Yeah. So it definitely, if you're into hiking, this is the area for you as well. Yeah, but I would, what?
Well, I was just about to say, we're probably not the tramping type.
No,
we're...
but I would stay somewhere like the Milford Lodge.
Well, that's the only place you can stay.
Right, and I would happily do a few couple-hour hikes. You know?
Oh, yeah, for sure. For sure.
I don't want to do a multi-day one.
No.
2 hours to carry the wine.
That'd be ridiculous. But, yeah, look, it's...
Tell me about where you can stay then. So there's one place to stay.
There's only one place to stay, which is the Milford Sound Lodge. Now, there's two styles of accommodation. They've got the secluded little huts.
Oh, they're stunning. Oh, yeah. My gosh, I want to stay there.
And there's also a premium camper van site.
Can you imagine, the little huts, you walk out, and not saying little huts, they're beautiful little rooms, wooden, and you walk out onto your balcony and looking at the mountains and that lush vegetation, all you would hear would be birds singing. It's, oh, my gosh. I'm going to put a link to the lodge and the camper.
I would say the rooms would be more like chalets.
That's it. You got it. But I was just going to say, I'm going to put a link to this on accommodation and the camper van park.
Well, the camper van also, camper van park.
I'll get it out third time, people, in the show notes.
Okay, sorry. Includes 24-hour kitchen. Yep. Guest lounge and laundry. Now, one thing it's important, no same day bookings.
So you can't just drive on in and stay. You have to book online beforehand.
Okay.
Yes.
Pre-bookings are online.
Yeah. So I'd probably call them because I'm an old fart and like to ask questions. So as I said, go to episode 77, in the podcast player on now, in the description. There'll be a link to the show notes, which has all the info on the accommodation and everything else we've been talking about as well, and plus all those stunning photos that I took. Yes.
Well, we've been talking about now going back to New Zealand in summer.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I think...
Doing a road trip everywhere.
Yeah, doing a road trip, because I'd love to go back to Milford Sound again.
In summer.
Oh, yeah. Unbelievable. But there is a town called Te Anahu, which is... approximately 120 kilometres from Milford Sound. Now, this particular...
And
little...
it's on Lake Te Anahu,
which
you talked about before, which was made all those years ago by the glacial movements.
So this particular town has got a population of about 2,760.
We're just going to say Milford Sound isn't a town. There's only that one place to say. There's no restaurants. There's only really the information centre there.
So you can't, and there's not even a shop.
You can't just park there at camper van either.
Whereas if you
want to have a few days in this area, the closest...
I'd definitely recommend
Te Anahu.
Yeah, which is a beautiful lake. It's only about a 2 hour drive from the sound.
Yeah.
And apparently the views and that on the way to Milford Sound are spectacular. You can swim in the lake.
Here we go.
The water temperature is between 12 and 15 degrees centigrade.
Yeah.
Now, in Fahrenheit, that's just as bloody cold. So I'd be taking a wetsuit if I could.
For information, Lyle won't swim in the ocean where we live until it's 22 degrees Celsius. So he would need a wetsuit. He'd need to be covered in a whole layer of fat on the outside and then another wetsuit. And
I just wouldn't do it.
Oh, God. I'd love to push it in.
Oh, no, no, you would. But what you can do at this beautiful, beautiful town.
Yes, because it's got restaurants and walk around. But, I think one of the top things is to walk around the lake, yeah?
Yep. You can also, obviously, there's lots of walks there, including the lake walk, as you said. You can obviously visit the Milford Sound. You can take a fishing charter.
Oh, yeah, I can.
There's a iconic Te Anahu bird sanctuary.
Okay.
And you were telling me about the glowworms.
Oh, yeah, there's caves with these glowworms. It looks amazing. I definitely would like to go and see that, yeah.
And you can also do a Fiordland jet boat, which is what's in Queenstown. They're everywhere.
Yeah.
They do the 360s and all that.
Yeah.
Now, Lake Te Anahu covers an area of 344 square kilometres or 133 square miles, making it the second largest lake by surface area in New Zealand after Lake Taupō and the largest in the South Island.
Yeah, now I've got some photos of Te Anahu on the lake there, and it's not quite as dramatic, obviously, as Milford Sound with the great big sheer cliffs.
The sheer cliffs, yeah.
But it is obviously as beautiful even as Lake Wakatipu in Queenstown. It's obviously not as much infrastructure around it. There is a lovely path, and it's got the trees that sort of going over the edge, you know, and there's the jetty that goes out. It's, yeah, it's pretty beautiful, actually. Yeah, I just, you know, I'd love to spend quite a bit of time there.
Well, one of the things that stands out to me about the South Island is there is so much water.
Yes, yeah.
Everywhere. There's lakes, there's rivers, it's just everywhere. And obviously because of the rainfall.
Yeah, everything's so lush and green as well.
Oh, it's just magnificent.
Yeah, so beautiful. And I just, once again, go to the podcast player you're listening on, the episode description. There's a link to episode 77, which has pictures of this, of Te Anahu as well. So, you know, I've got pictures of Milford Sound on the cruise, the waterfalls. I've got pictures of Te Anahu and, you know, on the lake there. And I've also got pictures of us landing and taking photos on the glacier, which is what we're going to talk about now, yeah?
Yeah.
Lyle, let's talk about the one thing you were most excited about.
Yeah, it was landing on the glacier. Yeah.
So we're in our helicopter. There's our pilot. We've got the perfect day.
Dan and Tegan.
Dan and Tegan, you know, and yeah, I don't know how else to describe flying in New Zealand. It's just mind blowing. There are just mountains and mountains covered in snow. It's so beautiful. And then all of a sudden, there seems to be a bit of a break in the mountains. And, you know, you realize that you're going to land and you're just, you know, thinking, holy shit, you know, have we got enough room here? And, you know, I don't know if I expected a sign to say this is a glacier. It sort of looks a bit like a snow-covered area. You know, but you're sort of at the top, and if you look at the photos, you can see it goes downhill from there. It's like this ice river, as you've described it, and you hop out, and you're just like, am I going to sink? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. And just I'm not sure it's to the left or the right. There was that frozen.
Yeah, as we took off, it was sort of down just to the front of us, like it. So it was.
And it had that really weird blue color.
It did. It was, and so frozen lake. So we all hop out and, you know, obviously the pilot's taken photos. We've got some nice photos of us posing and then bloody Dan pulls out the champagne, you know.
Yeah.
And, I thought he was going to get down on his knee and pop the question then, but sure. Maybe we sport the moment.
maybe, yeah, too
wouldn't
old.
Be like us to be obnoxious and
yeah,
loud.
Yeah, too old farts, yeah. Look,
and
it was...
you're standing there like you are literally on top of the world.
Yeah.
That's how you feel. I know there's many mountain ranges that are higher than that, but I've never had that feeling like I've had there before or since, just being in that spot.
The way I describe it is probably when we did this, I would say it's the most I'd paid for any sort of adventure or tour, yeah. Or
it's well over that,
whatever.
Just over $1,000
bucks. It's about, I think it was about $1,100 per person to do.
Yes.
At no point have I ever said, I wish I hadn't done it. It was too expensive. It was, to me, I can see it clearly in my mind now.
Yes.
And not only the helicopter flight, the cruise. And to fly through the mountains, through the middle of the mountains and these snow-capped mountains, it is, magical. Like as you say, it's almost like a fantasy.
Yeah. And I would do it again.
Without question.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I'm saying. I just think everyone should, if you go to this part of New Zealand, you know, just try and get somehow to get up in the air. Now, if you can't afford the helicopter flight both ways, there is, as we said, you can, you know, do a shorter flight. Like I did another wonderful helicopter flight with my daughter.
You did, and
it was only like a 20-minute flight, and we landed on the Remarkable Mountains, which is just outside Queenstown. That's where the Lord of the Rings was filmed. And the views, even there, even if you're not on a glacier, the views in this part of New Zealand from the air are, oh, look, so beautiful that you can't miss it. Like, everyone needs to do it.
Yeah, I'd probably, if we went back now, I'd probably, and did this again, I'd probably, and we had plenty of time, I'd probably do the coach.
Yeah.
Right?
And I'd do that.
So you've got plenty of time. You've got 6 hours in that. Then you do the cruise.
Yeah.
So that's 2 hours. And then fly back.
Yeah.
And do, or the heli fly back.
Or stay in Tianahu for a couple of nights.
Yeah. That's it. Yeah. If we're going to do it in the summer, yeah. Which, you know, there's more than likely we'll do that, I think.
Yeah, I think so. There's a few more wine regions we haven't been to, but that's a story for another day.
It is a story for another day.
But even being, you know, in the helicopter, you've got your earphones on and you can talk to the pilot and he's pointing out mountains and stuff. I mean, they all look the same to me, to be honest. But that will be a memory that stays with me for my lifetime, is hopping out of that helicopter and just, you know, I think I got my arms up in the air, just, you know, like I'm on the top of the world. It was incredible. And then, you know, like flying, well, you know, so you can actually go down and they take you down into the valley, into Milford Sound, you know, and that's, you just all of a sudden you come across this stunning, you know, water, mountains, waterfalls as well, you know, or as you take off, you see that as you head up through the valley, so you can go either way, you know. So we flew in and flew out, so it was so amazing, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was blown away.
And interesting, like when we were there, there was, I don't know, say 10 helicopters and little planes landing all the time, and our pilot said, you know, this is nothing compared to summer, you know, 3 or 4 times as many. So but it's all eco-friendly, of course, and just stunning. You have to go, yeah.
Yeah, and then we flew back to Queenstown and
we hung out with Tegan and Dan.
Yeah, we did. We had the rest of the day with Tegan and Dan, and we had an absolute ball.
We
ended up having dinner with the guys, and
yeah. One of us couldn't remember whether we'd eaten or not. That's what a good day we had, but we're not going to point any fingers at anyone, Tegan.
But we did. We had a really lovely day. They were great company. I mean, fabulous company. Really, really good company. Yeah. And hopefully one day we'll be able to do it again.
And, Lyle, so just to recap, this is episode 77, and all the photos of the places we've talked about, the helicopter flight, the glacier, I've got it all. I've got them all there in the show notes. So if you go to the podcast player you're on and you go to the link to episode 77, just click on that. It'll take you to the page where it has all those pictures. The other thing you can do is go to Instagram. We're at Beach Travel Wine, and you know, there's story highlights up the top. So we've got lots of stuff on New Zealand. I'll be putting videos up of Milford Sound, or, you know, like to go with this episode. So,
and I'll be surprised if those videos don't take your breath away.
Yeah. And if you're listening to this the day it's published, you might only get one. But a week after it's out, there's just gonna I've got a video to go up every day.
You're gonna bombard them.
I am, because I just couldn't choose which was the nicest, and I'm like, you know what? They're all beautiful. I'm gonna put them all up. Why wouldn't you? Yeah.
No argument from me.
Okay.
Well, you're in charge.
So it's a silly question. Do we have a favorite place to have a wine? I'm gonna get in first. My favourite place to not have a wine or a champagne.
Yeah.
We don't make that rookie error again.
No, I think if we went back, we definitely a nice spot of bubbles.
Anywhere in Milford Sound on a helicopter flight, on a glacier, is the perfect place.
On a cruise.
On the cruise. Any of those places, looking at Mitre Peak, looking at, you know, Stirling Falls.
You're saying that next time we go back, we actually stay at the Milford Sound Lodge.
There we go.
And we sit there and we have a beautiful, maybe a wet jacket.
Pinot Gris,
looking at the mountains.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could do that.
We could do that. But what I'm also saying is, it doesn't matter where you are in this beautiful area, it's a perfect spot to have a glass of wine. Yes?
Perfecto.
All right. Well, we look forward to seeing you next week, where we are actually going to be talking about wet jacket wine. So look forward to that.
Very well done, Leanne.
All right. See you next time.
Bye.